Hey there, welcome back to the podcast. Glad to have you listening. I have had a very memorable day, and I just wanted to capture a little bit of that, even on here, to post publicly that it might encourage you, that whoever might listen that knows me might get just a tiny glimpse into what happened in my life today and in my wife's life today. If you've been listening to any of the episodes over the last month or so, there's been this bend towards an upheaval of the will. I mean, goodness, that's been months. I mean, that's gone back to the beginning of when I started this thing. It's gone back for me years for sure, but this year has been like this sitting in a wagon on a steep hill, and boy, you better just hold on because we're just going in. We're just going at a fast rate of speed. We're going down into this new understanding of being abandoned. The living sacrifice reality that I'm just saying, like most people I've met think they've known, and that was me. I thought I knew. And I did in an incremental way. Yes, I did. But the depths that the Lord has himself in his power of his mercy has led me to a place that somewhere deep down within the deepest parts of who I am, I never thought I would be enabled, capable to ever travel to. You know, I just kind of resigned that there would always be something down there in me. There would always be a place in me that's just too much to face with absolute everything I have. I've been to levels of that in my life, of the emptying, of the giving myself, of the pouring myself out like a drink offering to the Lord, and dedicating myself, repenting, turning. And I'm not saying that that pattern is done, but like I go right now in this exact moment, I go to that teaching I did the other day about the woman at the well. Something for me was still rooted and established in my natural water pot reality. As Jesus said to her, he says to me, and he says to every one of us who's ever lived and breathed on this earth and ever will, look, you can keep coming back here to this well. You can keep coming back here, but you're going to consistently, every single time, run dry. You're going to run dry every time, for the water you're drawing from this well is natural water put into a natural vessel. And as long as that is your pattern, you cannot partake of the living water. And so as I shared in that teaching, and it's just continued to go deeper and deeper into my being, was the need for the exchange of the natural water pot vessel to be left at the well as I receive in faith the revelation of the living water. And for me, what was within that pot was all of my doctrine and theology and understanding on baptism that I don't claim to have ever perfected in rock solid, concrete, unshakable places, but it had become very firm. It had become very established for me what was before me, before my wife, before our family joining into something. And when God came in and he said, metaphorically speaking, through all of these scriptures, through the second chance people of God stuff, through the revelation that came to me through the John 3 Nicodemus dialogue with Jesus about have you entered the kingdom by the Spirit and by the water, I had to say no. There's something within this pot where I am perpetually drying out, and I have to keep coming back because I keep waiting and I keep waiting and I keep waiting and I keep waiting. So Jesus, the Messiah, offered me the living water. And I said, yes, I will take of it. I will drink. I will leave my pot at the well. The stuff with the Ethiopian eunuch and Philip intersecting, I recorded that the next podcast. That was the same day, the afternoon of the morning woman at the well recording. And this isn't about my recordings, y'all. This is about my life. This is about God speaking to me through his eternal word. That reality between the intersecting of what I have in my lap, the ancient scrolls of Isaiah. It's in my lap. I possess it. I'm holding it and I'm riding along and I'm trying to make sense of it. I do possess it. But until the Lord himself sends a revelation about what I possess, is of no use. My understanding, my doctrine, my belief that I'm riding along, holding so tightly, wanting to be right, wanting to give my all in absolute perfection, the best I'm able. And for me, I found that intersection of when my Philip came to me, the angel of the Lord, and said, do you know what you're reading? You know what? I don't know. I'm tired of riding along. Is there something for me to know that I've not yet known? Is there more to this? I don't understand. I lean not on my own understanding. And as I began to give myself to not leaning on my own understanding anymore, as right as it was, the Lord himself, by his Spirit, began to teach me and train me in all things concerning immersion. I'm not talking, I don't even want to say baptism because it's going to conjure up all these images of Pastor so-and-so with his hand on my back dunking me down in the water as he's wearing a white robe and reciting in the Father. I'm not saying all of that. That's not what I partook in today. I was immersed into the death of Jesus the Christ. I was joined into his death. And I have to just condense hours of things I could say into mere minutes. Another thing the Lord was speaking to me was the reality of like when I started giving myself to understanding the reality of joining myself into the death of the Messiah. I started saying, okay, Holy Spirit, teach me. What am I joining with? What am I joining myself into? And I found myself looking into the very last moments of Jesus' natural life. He's hanging on the cross. He has endured a life of suffering and denial of his own will. He's gone through the Garden of Gethsemane, suffering and agony and excruciating pain, alone. He goes to the cross, beaten, bloody, and naked, and he's hanging up on a tree as a display, as a centerpiece, high and lifted up as a showcase. Crushed. Laid bare. And what did he say before he breathed his last? Okay, the very end of the fulfillment of the personification of a consecrated, holy God-man. He said, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. And something clicked in me. Something clicked in me, brothers and sisters and friends and enemies and strangers. something changed in me when I read that. That was my problem. I had been trying to commit my spirit unto Yahweh, eternal God, the Father, without giving myself unto the death, without joining myself to the death. And I would say any man's journey that is missing this component of being born again, of being born of the Spirit, and being born of the water, lacks the ability to join completely into the death of Jesus Christ and therefore commit your spirit unto God. Because a man whose flesh is alive, a man whose natural water pot vessel is alive, and you are not living according to the living water, you cannot, you will not commit your spirit to Yahweh God. You cannot and you will not, because you are in opposition of His ultimate will. That's why Jesus could say at the end of His life, because remember, He said to everybody, don't you call me good. Don't you call me good. There's one who is good. Well, why did He say that? And I know I've said this before, because He knew he was in a flesh man body. He knew the confines of the just wretched body of flesh. He knew He had what? He lowered Himself. He stepped off of the throne to become you and me. And so because of that, he yielded His will into the grave. And only those who will do that, not believe the right doctrine, not believe the best things in the best way towards perfectly understanding what I'm even doing, it is a supernatural event. It is a supernatural event that I cannot understand, rationalize, write a paper on. I cannot, and I'm not supposed to. That's not the point. The whole point is the spiritual reality, the supernatural event that takes place. Only then could Jesus and any one of us commit our spirit, which is who we are, the real you, the real me. Only then, when we breathe our last, say, I commit all that I am. Now I can commit all that I am unto you. Jesus' action, His heart, His death was the covenant vow. Himself. And so when I join myself with His covenant, when I join myself with His vow keeps me. Today, friend, I went into that water by myself, with the people that I love more than anybody on the earth outside of my natural family and some of my natural family, on the side of the stream. And before them, I revealed every single molecule of my body that I know that I am. And I said, this is me. This is me. Put me on display. Peer into me, because when I do that before you, I do that before God Almighty. And I'm presenting myself to Him right now. And I went out into those waters. And friends, as I stepped out into that deep water that almost went up to my shoulders, it was everything I could do to physically stand. It was everything I could do to remain upright. And everything that I've been writing and praying and denying myself and pleading with the Lord to reveal to me what the Spirit is saying, what the Spirit is saying, I continually lay aside what I believe. I don't care what I believe. Because my faith has become alive. It's become present. It's become alive. It's my now revelation. It's my now understanding that only the Spirit of God, that's the wind that blows me anywhere it wants me to go, can bring me. And it blew me all the way out through these years of waiting and waiting and waiting. And I listened and I yielded in the time and season of that now moment for me and for my wife. And I went out into the water. And I just stood there. And I just tried to think on every single thing that God has been speaking to me over the last several weeks. Because as I said in the Hezekiah and the Second Chance People of God series, based upon the story of Hezekiah's call forth to return, when those people returned with their whole heart and when they responded to the revelation of God and who they were, it says in the scriptures, and it came about suddenly. And it came about suddenly. And when the Ethiopian eunuch met Philip and Philip revealed to him the absolute revelation of the Messiah that he was reading about preceding coming by the prophet Isaiah had now come. He had in fact come, fulfilled every single word and letter and act, and people were being baptized into his name, into the name of Yeshua. He said, what in the world is left? What in the world is left? I have received the revelation of the Messiah. And it demanded action. It demanded response. And so the problem for me, the problem for my wife, and the problem for every other man, woman, and child that ever walks this earth is, have we had a revelation of the Messiah? Have we had a revelation of the Messiah? Not have we read the best books about baptism that make sense to us, or any other doctrine of men that's been told to me? Have I had a revelation of the Messiah? Because only a revelation of the Messiah gets you up there to go into his death and join into his committing himself, his entire self, unto the Father. The Spirit into him. A joining into. My death is my side, my part of the vow. My willful death, my living sacrifice is the part, my part of the covenant. But it's his covenant. It's his vow that keeps me and will keep me and will keep me and will keep me and keep me and keep me forever for the rest of my days. It's his perfect vow. I've vowed to a million things in my life. God, I'll never again. I promise. Never again. I promise. To my wife, sweetie, I'm sorry. Never again. Never again. And I meant it every time. But I was doing all of it through a vessel of clay. I was doing all of it through a temporary vessel of water that would continually run out and run out and run out. Natural, natural, natural. A natural man response to a supernatural call to be joined with the Messiah. He himself is my vow. And that can never be broken. No man, no thing, no principality and power can ever take what I did today. It cannot be touched. Why? Because it's not mine. It's the vow of the Messiah. The firstborn of the many brethren. I was born of the water today. Do you see what I'm saying, friend? I was not just baptized. Oh, that was my baptism today. No, sir. No way, no how. I was immersed into joining into the death of the Messiah. For 4 years, my wife and I have been riding along metaphorically in that chariot. And man, we've had revelation. We've had revelation in measure towards baptism, and it's been expanded and expanded and expanded and expanded. But it never made its way into the every crack and crevice of my spirit. And that, when it started getting in there, when I started declaring my need for God, when I started yelling out of my mouth, God, I need you. I need you. And confessing my sin, and confessing my flaws, and confessing my disappointments, exposing the issues of my life that go back and span the whole length of my entire life. And I say, I don't care anymore. I don't care anymore. And I'm dying. And I'm dying, and I'm dying, and I'm dying, and one thing leads to another, to another, to another, and to another, and that takes you to what I started saying at the beginning, was I'm in this wagon, and you cannot stop it. I'm going down. I'm going down. And one confession, one supernatural touch after another in those places that I continually expose myself to led me to the water. It led me to be born of the water today. I didn't go into a denomination. I didn't go into a sect of a fellowship. I didn't go into a people group. Friends, I went into Yeshua, the very Son of God, my great high priest, my mediator, my sympathizer, my rescuer, my deliverer. I went into him today. I was supernaturally joined with him. And when you line up all these other things, all these extras, they look like grains of sand. Too small. Too small. Too small. Too small. I went into the very Son of God today. I was supernaturally joined and unioned with the Messiah. The intersection, the revelation came. And it replaced every other thing I understood, knew, planned on, bet on, put my life and future into. All of it was deemed too small, too small. The Lord kept saying that. I'd get up in the morning and I'd pace the driveway before sunrise. And the Lord would keep saying, Joel, it's too small. Come out. It's too small. Lay it down. It's too small. Lean not on your own understanding. It's too small. Give yourself to me. It's too small. Yes, Lord. Yes, I'm coming out. I'm coming out. It's So I wrote pages upon pages over the last couple weeks. Yesterday alone, I wrote a dozen pages of typed out stuff. And y'all, all of it, as awesome as it is, and what the Lord has shown me has been great. It will remain with me the rest of my days. But that question that I asked and I asked and I asked is what is keeping me from being immersed? What is keeping me from being immersed into the Messiah? Friends, today, around 1 o'clock, I entered these beautiful living waters and I said nothing. 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 My conscience is cleared. I have made an appeal to the eternal Yahweh God. I have been given a clear conscience. The veil has been rent. The blood has cleansed me. My enemies are going to their graves. I am coming out delivered. I'm no longer looking at the kingdom that has been, I've perceived it. No, no longer. I'm entering in. And I went under those waters. And it might as well have been a dream. It might as well have been some vision experience. It was the most beautiful thing I've ever experienced. And then I had the awesome privilege of seeing my wife do the same thing mere moments later. And I've seen some pretty awesome things in my 46 years of life, including joining myself with her. But friends, nothing, nothing I believe, nothing I know, nothing I'm waiting to apprehend and do perfectly could ever come within 10 million miles of what my immersion into the Messiah revealed to me today and did to me in me. So may this story of my day, this nobody guy, y'all, in the sense of like the natural, I've got nothing interesting to offer. But today, if you're hearing this message, you're hearing a man who is the worst of sinners be joined with the eternal God through the death of his son. I was able, because of his vow, because of his covenantal commitment to Father God that surpasses my understanding, that I have unioned myself with him. I've joined myself with him. By dying as much as I will ever die until I breathe my last. And I cross over into whatever time frame, time period is going on then. And I await the glorified, beautiful, perfect, perfected body that I will indwell for the rest of all of eternity. But friends, today, this mortal body died. All things have become new. As I said the other day, and oh man, I didn't even understand, and it was only a week ago. All things become new. The beauty of the new. Listen to what I'm saying. Do you have that? Are you clinging to a doctrine? Are you clinging to, hey, I did that. All right, back off. Are you clinging to anything? Do you have a water pot that cannot hold the living water? If you do, friends, leave it. Lay it down. I am telling you firsthand, you have no idea if you have not experienced what I just said. Take what I've just said and multiply that by 100, and we might be getting close to being able to articulate how I feel tonight. My wife and I are going to be going to bed tonight, joined and unioned with the Messiah. Incredible. Incredible. Praise be to Yahweh God, for His ways are right. His ways are pure. His ways are perfect. His covenantal vow that I now possess and am in is perfect. May it accomplish its ways. May it accomplish its purposes in me, in my wife, and in every other saint that's gone before me, who is now in it, and who now ever, and whoever will be in days ahead. May it accomplish its supernatural purpose to join us with Himself. Amen.